In this video, I'm going to show you how to use Spline to easily get 3D content into your iOS app in SwiftUI. We're going to build this onboarding screen that you see here because that's a pretty common use case that will apply to most of you out there. But the main lesson is showing you how to get these 3D designs from Spline into Xcode in SwiftUI. Because once you know how to do that, you can use 3D content in your iOS apps, iPad apps, visionOS apps, however you like. Spline did reach out to sponsor this video, and after seeing a bunch of iOS devs on Twitter talking about this product, sharing how cool it is, I was pumped to work with them. Here I am in Xcode with a basic starter project. You see the screen is a basic V-stack. This gray rectangle here, that's my placeholder for the 3D content. Then I have a V-stack for my, you know, title and little blurb. Then I have a spacer and a get started button. Very basic SwiftUI, but if you want to follow along in real time, go ahead and pause the video here and type that out real quick. But like I said, this rectangle is the placeholder for our 3D content. But how do we get that content into Xcode? How do we animate it like you see here? That's where Spline comes in. And it's a no-code workflow to create 3D content for the Apple ecosystem. It's a design tool like a Sketch or a Figma, but specifically for 3D designs. Like, their goal is to make it easy to create 3D content for Apple platforms in the web. Side note, they released a 15-minute Apple-esque keynote showcasing their features. I recommend checking it out. It'll give you a bunch of cool ideas. Link will be in the description. Here I am in Spline. You can use their web app, but this is the macOS app. That's what I chose to use. But let's talk about you getting this 3D content because you're an iOS developer. It's highly unlikely that you're also a very good 3D artist as well. So there's a few ways to go about this. Of course, you could hire a 3D artist if you have the funds for your app, or maybe you're at a company that already has one. Or you can use pre-existing content. For example, Spline in their library has a bunch of scenes that you can use here. I'll scroll down. You can see all these scenes with multiple objects. See, they got iPhones, Apple Watches, all kinds of good stuff. Even a whole bunch of individual objects, right? Because this scene that you see here, right? This is a bunch of stuff all in one scene. But if you want just individual objects, they have a whole nice little library for this as well. Scroll down a bit, right? You get the Coke can, the Red Bull, houses. There's a whole bunch of this that Spline provides, and you can use these out of the box, but there's also a community tab, and you can see like what the community is sharing. So this nice little glass material. So this is like what you can use out of the box if you want, but you can also take these files, right? I'm gonna hit remix, and it's gonna prepare my file. And if I go up to retro glass material, now I'm in the actual design tool, and you can see I can edit this, change this however I like to suit my needs. And not just with the community stuff, you can do this with anything in the library. And that's what we're gonna do in this video. I'm gonna take this scene right here, remix it, make it our own, make it suit our needs for this onboarding screen that you see here with the animation. And lastly, back to the Spline homepage and tutorials, if you're really ambitious, you can learn 3D design yourself, and Spline has a ton of great tutorials walking you through how to create all this cool stuff in Spline. And if you're developing for Apple Vision Pro and this whole spatial computing, you know, into the future, I think it's gonna really benefit you to have at least some basic knowledge of 3D design. You don't have to be a full-blown 3D artist pro, but just basic knowledge, go through some of these tutorials, play around in here. I think that skill set is going to serve you amazingly in this world of spatial computing. And like I said, Spline has a ton of tutorials that you can go through. And the great thing about, you know, working and building all this stuff in Spline that you're gonna see here is that we're gonna export it and it's ready-made for Xcode and SwiftUI and so easy to use in your apps. But this video isn't about teaching you how to design, how to use the design tool. It's about how do we get this design here into Xcode and SwiftUI so we can use it in our app. So I have my basic design selected. Let me go back to the home screen so I can show you what I did here because it may have been quick, right? I went to the library, scrolled down, I found a scene I like for our onboarding. It's this one right here. I clicked on it, and when I did, it opened up this tab up here that you see, kind of like the Xcode tabs, and we have our design. So the first thing I'm going to do is export this and bring it into our app, because you're gonna see, just as is, out of the box, it's not gonna work out well for us. So we need to make tweaks to this, which is a good opportunity to show you how you can customize these designs to suit whatever needs you like. So let's export it. You can see there's a nice little export button up here. Now, the cool thing about the export that we're gonna see over here on the left, public URL viewer, this is all like web stuff. You can see you do files, images, videos, but there's very specific Apple platforms. See this Apple platform section here? You can generate an entire app on your own, but we're iOS developers. We don't need that. VisionOS volumes and spaces. I might do another video about VisionOS later. This is more for, you know, iPhone development because it's where most of you are. You know, not too many people are on VisionOS quite yet. So embed iOS. So when I click on this, you see I already get the Swift code there. You can see it a little bit, and it gave me a URL. So we have two options, and we'll dive into this as we're actually building the code. You can run this stuff from the cloud remotely, and you know your iOS app will make a network call to pull in the information to show your 3D render. Or as you see here, you can download the scene to local. And of course there's trade-offs, right? If you're doing it remotely, you can change anything here in your design on the fly and it will update in your app. You don't have to submit another app update. But now you're dealing with like network calls and all the internet stuff and all the edge cases that go on there. Like if your user doesn't have the internet, what do you show? So that can be a headache. So you can download them and bring them in local. But the trade-off there, even though you don't have to deal with network calls and everything will be super fast, is, for example, this file was roughly like 13 megabytes. So if you have one of those, two of those, not a big deal. If you have 20 of these in your app, well, now your app bundle, the download is going to get really, really big. So you may not want that. So trade-offs, you know, make the right decision for your app. During the first part of the tutorial, I'm going to do it via the cloud because I'm going to make changes to this design so we can see those changes happen in real time in our app. So I'm going to copy this code snippet. You see import Spline runtime. We're going to have to bring in the package. And it gives us a content view. I kind of wish we could make this window bigger to like preview it, but we'll just have to copy it and go back to Xcode and paste it and hope we get what we want. So I'm not gonna paste it over this content view, even though that's what it had. Like I said, I'm replacing this gray rectangle that you see here. So I'm gonna go down and create another view. We'll call it a struct. We'll just say onboard 3D view. Nothing special. Again, naming is hard. Name it whatever you like. Do var body some view. There we go. And actually, I'm going to paste it right above that, and then we'll kind of take what we need, right? So import Spline runtime. We know we're going to need that. So I'm going to cut that and go up to my imports up here. Again, I'm using what I just pasted, and I'm going to like pick it apart. We have to import the package, right? We don't have Spline runtime yet. We'll get there. So I'm going to take everything in the body, right? Because I already have var body some view. So I'm going to copy that, paste it into there, and then delete this content view and import SwiftUI. Again, that's just an artifact of what we pasted in. We pulled out what we needed. So now I can delete all that, which then leaves us with just our onboard 3D view with our body. And you can see we have the two options, right? If we're fetching from the cloud, we want to use this URL, and it gave us the URL. If we're fetching from local, we have to download the file, bring it into our project. We're going to do that at the end. Again, we're going to stick with the cloud for now. But you see, you're just pulling the bundle with the name of the file. And then here's our Spline view with the URL, and then ignore safe areas, what they gave us. We already have that up here on our like rectangle. So I'm going to delete that down here. And if we go back and replace rectangle, we can also get rid of foreground style, replace rectangle with onboard 3D view, and we're not good to go because we need the Spline package. So let's go file, add package dependencies. Here's Spline iOS. You can either search for Spline iOS or paste in this GitHub link that you see here. I obviously had to rehearse this video and practice this video, so I've already searched for it, so it's in my recents. So add the package, add it. There we go, do a command B to get everything building. Build succeeded. You see my preview refreshing, and there we go. Here is our 3D design. If I go back to Spline, well, I'm going to get rid of the export. You can see there it is. But I want this whole view. You can see it's very zoomed in, right? Like it doesn't like fit our phone, right? If I look at the finished product, you see it's nice and small and it's animating. So that's what we're going to tweak. So back to Spline. Now this does have a bit of a learning curve, just like any design tool. Again, think if you've ever used Sketch or Figma. It took you a little bit to learn. Spline has a bunch of tutorials and videos to help walk you through this. But I'm going to show you what I did to get the desired outcome that I want. So first things first, right? This is like too big. So I took the size, took it down to 50%. You see, that's much smaller. And then I don't need all this pink stuff behind. So you click this button here, which is edit frame. So there we go. So now I drag the frame down here to get it more, you know, like reasonable for what I needed for my iOS app. So there you go. Close that out, get back to this. So now let's test this out. So export, again, because I'm running from the cloud, right? We didn't download the local files. If I download the local files, I would have to download them again, re-import them. So I think if you're tweaking your designs, probably best to do it from the cloud. And then, you know, when you have your finished product, then you got to make the decision on if the cloud or local is best for you and what you're trying to do. But anytime I make those changes, right, I can hit update. But actually, let's go to play settings because I want to do this too. So these are basically how you can interact with the 3D designs. So I'm going to change orbit to one fingers because I can't remember how to do a two finger gesture on the simulator and it's just easier to point and drag. So that's orbit. So I'm going to hit update. And now without doing anything in Xcode, right, I'm not going to change anything. Now that it's updated, let's go back. Again, this should go on the fly. Let me refresh my preview. and it should be smaller. There you go, it fits. And then now I can tap and drag. I couldn't do that before. So with Orbit, you can see I'm all over the place. Like I don't, and the user has to like touch this to drag it. So again, if you want the user to be able to manipulate your 3D object by touching and dragging, there you go. You don't have to do anything else. But I want the Orbit to only be horizontal, right? I'm trying to mimic my animation here. I'm kind of just going side to side. I don't want to be able to go like this. So I can limit my Orbit to horizontal only. So let's do that. Well, Orbit limits, you can also set like how far left and right they go. I'm not gonna do that. Actually, you know, I do need orbit limits because I need just horizontal. There we go. And hit update. So that'll keep updating it. Now let me show you how I can kind of tweak the design. So as you see in my onboard, I say build your brand because all this stuff around them kind of look like social media, like liking it, you know, comments, music. So it's kind of like mimicking a social media app. By the way, this built with Spline logo is only because you're on the free plan. If you pay for it, you don't have that watermark there. But back to the design. Let's say I didn't want those icons. So I see I said icons on the left, hit the little eye thing. We'll just hide those for now. This sphere, like I can touch every little element. Say this sphere over here on the right. Let's color. I wanted to make it, I don't know, blue. You see that sphere turned to blue now. And any one of these, I can adjust where they go, right? Let me move this person. I want him over there. So my point is, you get this nice design out of the box, but you have full control, full reign to tweak it, move it around, play with it, change the colors, you know, delete some stuff if you don't like it. Speaking of, I'm gonna get back my icons. And of course, the better you are with the design tool Spline, if you take the time to learn, the more you're gonna be able to take this basic design and really make it your own. Okay, so I wanted to be able to pan it to show you that, but actually I don't want my user to be able to do this orbit. So this orbit, I'm gonna disable. Pan, I'm gonna disable. Like I don't want my user to be able to pinch to zoom, disable, page scroll, no. I don't want my user interacting with this, right? If we look at the design, it's just a nice, slowly animating, subtle thing, right? It's not meant to be interactive. But again, if your app, you need your 3D objects, they have like a sneaker, a shoe, and you want the user to be able to do all that, don't do this, right? Keep it. But ours is just purely visual and aesthetic, so no interaction here. I will hit update. So now the last thing I want to do, and this gets into animations, is, like I said, I want this slow animation to pan, right? If I hit this play button here, by the way, this is how you can interact. I'm clicking and dragging. Like this is the animation I want, right? This slow pan. Okay, so you don't get that for free. You have to create the animation. And it's very similar to keyframes if you've ever dealt with that. So I wanna add a camera. So if I hit this plus button, this is how you add elements to the design, right? All kinds of shapes, particle emitters. Again, this is a full-blown design tool. I know I'm glossing over a lot of things because it's just too deep. And this isn't about design. This is about bringing the design into Xcode. But I wanted to show you a little bit of customization. So I'm gonna add a camera. Okay, so now that I have my camera, you see it up over there. I'm gonna change my viewport to the camera because the personal camera is the default one, but I'm adding a camera to this scene. Okay, so I wanna add states and events. So when you're animating something, you're animating it from a base state to another state. It's kind of like keyframe animations if you've ever done that. So let's do that. So states, so the base state, now I wanna set this on the camera here. I will hold option on the camera. I'm gonna drag it over here. So let's say this is where the animation starts, right? That's my base state. That's where I'm gonna be the start. Looks like a good angle. I mean, you can really dial it in if you're being serious here. And you saw the numbers over here move. So that's my base state. Now, if I go to my end state, again, watch the numbers there. You'll see it move as I drag. I'm gonna go over here and say that's the end state. So it's gonna animate from that state to the other state. All right, so if I add an event, you'll see I want a transition. There's a whole bunch of other ones here, but we're gonna add a transition because we're gonna transition from that base state, not current, from base state to the state. And I wanna do this over 20 seconds because I want it to be nice, slow, and subtle. I don't want it to be a super fast animation. And these are animation curves. You can change all that. I just want linear, nothing crazy here. Now the loop, I want this to go back and forth infinitely, right? So it's an onboarding screen. Hopefully they get by it pretty quick, but if for some reason they stay on the screen, it'll just animate back and forth slowly and it'll just ping pong back and forth. So that is our event. If I hit play, I see the animation slowly, right? That's exactly what we want. That's slow and subtle animation. So I'm gonna close out of here. Now again, export. I should just be able to hit update. And again, we're working from the cloud, so our app is gonna make a network call to pull this in. And if I go back to Xcode, let me do something here, just delete the M, type the M again to refresh my preview. And there you go, the user can't interact with it, right? I'm trying to click around Zoom. Nope, it's just a nice visual on an onboard screen, subtle animation, and we're gonna let it go a little bit and you'll see it ping pong back the other way. But again, creating cool 3D animations in your app, I think it just adds an extra little high polish look. All right, now we're going back the other way. Again, subtle, 3D, high polish, really think this can add to your app. Now let's talk about local, right? We've been working with the cloud. And this is actually pretty simple because you see they already give you the code. Here's what you do fetching from the cloud. Here's what you do fetching local. But if we go back to Spline, on the export, you see this button here, download the scene to local. So I'm gonna download it. I'm going to sort of name it relaxing copy or whatever room. I'm just gonna say onboard. And in the desktop, I'm going to put it into my Spline file, which has nothing in there or folder. So again, back to Xcode. Now I'm going to comment out this URL from the cloud. I don't want that URL. And I'm going to uncomment the bundle URL, except you see I named it, just crashed my preview, here's why. Because I named, well, first of all, there's nothing in here. Let me go to desktop, spline, let me drag onboard spline in there. Yep, do all up, make sure it's added to the target. And instead of scene, right, that's not the name of the file. The name of the file is onboard. That's why the preview is crashing, because it's like, hey, what is this file? I don't know what that is. Okay, so now we're running it from the local resource and you see the same thing happening, right? We get the same thing. But again, back to that trade-off. If I go to my Finder, if I look at this onboard spline, right click, get info, you see it is 13.2 megabytes. So again, if you have one or two of these, probably not the end of the world. If you have 20 of them, it's gonna blow up your app. So again, that's the trade-off between the cloud and local. A quick note about some minimum specs. On iPhones, it does require iOS 16 and above, or macOS 13 and above. And you gotta be on Apple Silicon Mac. And I believe the A13 chip and above. So pretty high standards when it comes to operating systems and devices, but that's because it's using the latest and greatest. As you can see, it looks great on iPhones, iPads, but I really think visionOS and moving forward with spatial computing, that's where this is really gonna shine, and I can't wait to see it.